A unique effect of Hawaii's extreme isolation is one of the highest percentages of endemic plant and animal species on Earth. Our forests evolved and adapted over millions of years, arguably a true paradise.
There have been a few descriptions of our native forests that describe them like perfectly tuned engines with parts that are completely adapted to the natural dynamic of these islands. The trees and undergrowth are ideally suited for attracting and then capturing water. Streams and rivers channel the water down our mountains and valleys into the ocean. The nutrients carried by the fresh water provide sustenance for many forms of aquatic and marine life. It's a cycle that went unbroken for millions of years. Biologist Hannah Bernard has been a tireless advocate for Hawaii's nearshore areas. She's the co-founder of the Hawaii Wildlife Fund and has spent the last 22 years on Maui.
The concept of mauka toward the mountain and makai toward the ocean is, I think, analogous to the watershed orientation that most people from continental landmasses or in the West think of. The watershed where the rain falls in the mountains and then it works its way down through the stream valleys and into the water table and into the groundwater and eventually to the ocean. And so when we talk here in Hawaii about mauka to makai, we're talking about that connection, the mountain to the sea. And what's typical of our streams is they're what's called flashy. They experience flash floods. We have big amounts of water coming through our valleys with big rainfall. And so in the old days, when our forests were intact and the taro farmers were intact, we had thousands of taro patches all over the islands. Thousands, hundreds of thousands. There was more control of sediments reaching the ocean. So less damage to our coral reefs. So our coral reefs are in trouble now because our sediments are running off the land. They're not being retained. They're not being managed very well. In fact, they're being encouraged to flow freely with the way that we develop in our estuaries, we develop in our floodplains, and we're grading too much land at a time and putting too many impervious surfaces all over our islands. So we like to promote that which is still good, still alive here, which is an example for the world, how to live in harmony with the environment.
Because Hawaiians had less resistance to common communicable diseases, these first people were reduced to less than 50,000 individuals. It took less than a century for this to happen. Obviously, taro production was affected. Introduced cash crops like sugar were being exploited. The 20th century Hawaiian Renaissance helped to restore and save our indigenous Hawaiian ways. It also helped many folks living in Hawaii to recognize that traditional Hawaiian foods like taro have great health benefits.
To me, it seems so natural because I understand the importance of the connection of mauka to makai, because especially living in the island, you see how everything on land affects the ocean, everything, super fast. And so the wonderful thing about taro farming is, you know, aside from all the cultural wonder about it, is that ecologically it's a force of management of stream flow. So stream flooding is actually controlled, and it was controlled to a large extent all over the islands. The way the Hawaii channeled the water into the lo'i, and then the water would be trapped and it would be managed. And so, of course, great flooding would still go down the stream valley, but a lot of water would be managed and then put back in the stream, usually cleaner, because the sediments would be retained in the taro patches in the lo'i. And so the other thing about the way taro farming was done traditionally was having fish in the lo'i, and they provided fertilizer for the taro and then the protein, the food for the people to eat. So no need for synthetic fertilizers, which people use now and find their way to our ocean. So everything was much more in balance. We talk about sustainability. And to me, that means living in balance with your environment, with your ecosystem, which the Hawaiians did. And they were the models in the old times for how to live within your means, to live in a way that you're recognizing your finite resources, you're recognizing that you live on an island, that the resources are very limited, and so you need to take really good care of them.